morning today. Well, God bless you for being here. If you're here for the first time or you have a special need that you'd like to tell us about, if you fill out the little form that's inside of your, on the edge of your bulletin and turn it in a little bit later, that would be a wonderful thing. We're glad you're here. You also notice some things fall out of your bulletin this morning. There's a newsletter in there for the month of April. Of course, next Sunday is Easter Sunday. No fooling. Next Sunday, it comes a little early this year, but Easter Sunday, invite somebody with you. Let's get this place completely packed. And I'm so glad you're here this morning. There's something else that you could fill out in your bulletin this morning. We're going to start April with the celebration of the resurrection of Christ, and we're going to end April with the celebration of the church, because we are the bride of Christ, and we're something to celebrate. And I'm not sure about you, but I love my church. I love my church. And you know when I say that, I'm saying I love you. I really do, and this is it. We're going to have a day where we celebrate the church, and it's the church which Christ died for. So in that celebration, the last Sunday in April, we'll have a carry-in basket dinner. That's what I heard you said. Basket. Is that right? Basket dinner. Bring a lot of food. We're going to provide fried chicken. We're also having a t-shirt sale. Let me say something about the t-shirt. You don't have to have a shirt, but you might want to have a shirt that day, because a lot of people are going to be wearing, and yes, I am too, a shirt that says, I love my church, a big red heart, and Calvary Baptist Sedalia. You know what these shirts will do besides everybody wearing them on that day? Is they're going to be walking advertisements in our community for our church. They'll be walking advertisements every time you wear it. And somebody's going to look at you and say, they may have had a bad experience in church. And they may have quit going to church. Or they may have never gone to church. But they're thinking, I need to go to church. And I want to go to a church where people love their church. So get yourself a shirt. Jenny, raise your hand. Stand up, Jenny. Jenny's one of our newer members. She is going to be down at the end of the hallway after church where you can sign up. But you can also sign up in your bulletin. It is a form you can fill out. Somebody was just filling, you were just filling that out. Would you hold it up so they know you have a form? You gave it to Jenny. Okay, fill out the form and you can pay the money later. We're going to trust you. But if you haven't paid the money by the time we order the shirts, we're not going to order you one, okay? We're only ordering shirts for people who pay their $8 for regular sizes, and that's children on up through adult extra large. And then for those of us who might be a little bigger, if you want a double X, it'll cost a little more, and you can even get triple through 5X if you need that. So more material, more money. Anyway, well, this is a great day. The choir's ready, and we're going to sing. I'll hear them sing. We're going to sing in a minute. But we want to be in prayer for some folks. I heard Tom Callahan is in the VA hospital with a heart issue. Let's be in prayer for Tom. Come on, Jeannie. They haven't started yet. Let's be in prayer for Tom. And then I looked back there and see Bud. Bud, we love you, brother. And I was there yesterday to see Dolores. And since she's come home, she is under hospice care. Now, she told me this. She said, Preacher, that doesn't mean I'm giving up. It means I'm going to get some help. That sounds good, doesn't it? Because you can use that help. So, be in prayer. And I think a miracle just walked in the back door there. Is that Mariah back there?
No.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. We pray for you, Mariah. We want you to know that. We're glad you're here. Let me say this. God is still in the miracle-working business. Let me just say this real quickly about Dolores. She said, Dolores said to me yesterday, she said, Pastor, I'm a miracle. Because it was April of last year that I was diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. And she lives to April, and I feel like she will. She's a miracle. She's a miracle. And Mariah, you're a miracle too. God bless you. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name today. Thank you for Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who came to pay or take away the sins of the world. And all who will trust in him as their only hope for heaven will receive that salvation. Thank you for this day of celebration. Thank you for the choir that will share. Thank you, Lord, for being Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. Lord, we thank you that Mariah is with us today, God. And we pray for your continued healing in her life. And we pray, Father, for Dolores, and God, that you would touch her body and heal her in accordance to your will. Give her grace and strength. And I pray for Bud, that he'll be able to walk soon with that prosthesis. And God, I lift up Tom Callahan, who's in the hospital. I pray you touch and heal Tom. Lord, I thank you for this church family that evidently loves you and loves one another. And I pray, God, you continue to strengthen us. Continue to add to those of our number. Thank you for Michael, Judy, and all of the choir who have worked hard to prepare what they're going to share with us today. And I pray, God, that you will be pleased, that you will be honored, glorified, and lifted up, Jesus. Now I pray you bless all that is said and done for your honor and glory this day.
Stand, if you would. This is going to be an all-in-one offertory hymn number 142. There is a fountain.
Thank you. I baptize with water, John replied. But among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the thongs of those whose sandals I am not worthy to untie.
The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world.
We crown you.
Each man is to take a lamb. All the people of the community must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and tops of the door frames of the houses.
On that same night I will pass through, and I will bring judgment. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. This is a day you are to commemorate for the generations to come. Sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. Stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Brothers, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. Seeing what was ahead, he spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that he was not abandoned to the grave, nor did his body see decay. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of the fact. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, and has poured out what you now see.
On the throne.
to the Lamb.
Receive me. Revelation 22, you know, Revelation is the conclusion. Revelation is what's going to happen in the future. And in Revelation 22, the last invitation, pretty much, of the Bible, in verse 17, the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him who hears say, come. And whoever is thirsty, let him come. And whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life. Come to the one. When we think of the Lamb, we need to think of the one who said, if you will drink of me, if you will trust in me, if you will depend upon me, you will never thirst again, because he quenches our everlasting thirst. And then, John chapter 19 again, he says these words. John chapter 19. When he had finished the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. The Greek word was something like, it was one word, it was tetelestai. Tetelestai. The job is complete. The work is accomplished. It is finished. Now, if we decide we want to work for our salvation and earn our way to heaven, let me tell you what, folks, it will never be done. One of the reasons why it would never be done is we don't know how much we have to do. We're never done. Not only would we never be done, but we would never be sure that we're saved. Now, I'm a Baptist through and through. I was Baptist born. I was Baptist bred. I was almost Baptist wed. My wife and I met on non-denominational turf. She didn't know when she got married to me. She was married a future Baptist preacher. And that's because I didn't know that either. I was so naive when we got married. Not about getting married. Now, I knew what I wanted there. I was so naive that I thought I was going to be a youth minister all of my life. But let me tell you what happens with a lot of youth ministers. They grow up and become pastors. And that's what I did. I was a youth minister for 10 years. But it is finished. The task is accomplished. Christ died. We can't work for that salvation, because there's nothing we can do that could give us the eternal life that God could give us. But Jesus said, it is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. It is finished. He has accomplished the task of paying for your sin and my sin. And it would be a crying shame for anybody who's listening to me today, whether you're live and in person or whether you see this on YouTube, on the internet, it would be a shame for you to die without Christ, because he paid for your sin. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace. All day long, Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. And it is by his finished work on the cross of Calvary that we are offered salvation. Just a couple of verses about that from Hebrews chapter 10. You see, the common belief in the world, the common belief is that if you're good enough, you can go to heaven. And if you're not good, you will go to hell. Good people go to heaven. Bad people go to hell. The problem with that is that there aren't any good people. There's a country song right now titled, Most People Are Good. And it's a cute song, and it talks about mama, and it talks about, you know, mothers and how they all ought to be saints. And it's a cute song, but it's wrong. No people are good would be correct. You know, you say, well, I'm not that bad. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And until you realize that you're bad enough, that you can't be good enough to get to heaven, and that only Jesus Christ can pay for your sins, you can't be saved. If you think you're good enough, you're not. And by the way, on a Sunday morning, in a great church like this, and we are, I love this church, I really do love my church, there might be somebody here who thinks you're good enough. And if you think you're good enough, I've got newses for uses. You're not. You're not. But this is what God did for us. In Hebrews chapter 10, in verse 13, and you know, in the Old Testament, they had the lamb they sacrificed. They sacrificed the lamb at Passover when they were getting ready to be delivered from Egypt. They sacrificed the lamb and they put over the doorpost. They put it here, and they put it here, and they put it here, and they put it down here. You know why they did that? His head had a crown of thorns, and his hands had nails in it. His feet had nails in it. And it was a picture, that picture, the lamb that was sacrificed at Passover was a picture of the Lamb of God who would take away the sin of the world. And the way that he took it away by crucifixion. And if you haven't seen that movie yet, I can only imagine. I recommend you go see it. And one of the things about, what an incredible movie, but one of the things about that movie that was so dramatic to me was the scene of the crucifixion. Oh my goodness. How realistic that scene was. It wasn't a pretty place. There was a lot of blood. There was a lot of hatred. They were killing a perfect man, the Lamb of God. But it says here in Hebrews 10, verse 10. It says that by that will we have been made holy. We've been made perfect in God's sight through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Christ died one time for all men for all sin. And then in verse 14, because by that one sacrifice, the sacrifice of the Lamb, by that one sacrifice, he has made perfect in God's eyes forever those who are sanctified, those who are being made holy. Have you looked to the Lamb? Children of Israel were a stubborn people, and they didn't learn very well. One of the things they did a lot was complain. Murmur, 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 dispute, dispute, dispute. And one time when they were complaining, God sent poisonous snakes. Now, can you just imagine for a moment? Here at Calvary, we're having a business meeting, and we're disagreeing about something. And by the way, that's why some people don't go to business meetings, is they don't want to disagree about anything. But can you just imagine we're having a business meeting, and I don't know of any disagreements right now, but if we were having a business meeting and we were disagreeing with one another, and all of a sudden poisonous snakes showed up. Business meeting over. There you go. I don't think that would be good. It might stop us from complaining, but it didn't really stop the children of Israel from complaining, and they started dying from the poisonous snake bite. By the way, I don't know the difference between a poisonous snake and a garden variety snake. And in my opinion, the only good snake is a what? Dead snake. You're right. That's the way I kind of feel about snakes. And if there's any snake lovers here, I'm sorry. And we're not going to become snake handlers. But what happened there in the Old Testament with the children of Israel, when all of these snakes were killing the people, complaining, God told Moses, get a pole and put on that end of that pole a brazen serpent and hold it up and tell the people, all who look to this snake will live. And many people lived. But some people wouldn't look at the snake. All they had to do was look and live. Well, Jesus was lifted up. He said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men to myself. He said, if I be lifted up, he said, he will draw you if you'll look to him. And that's when he gave the verse, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son to be lifted up on a cross, that whosoever behaves, whosoever believes, trusts in, depends upon him, will not perish. They will have everlasting life. If you're not sure today that you have everlasting life, behold the Lamb. Look to the Lamb and live. Would you pray with me? Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Nobody's looking around. It's just between you and God. Would you look to the Lamb and live today? If you're not absolutely sure that Jesus is your Savior, that your sins are forgiven, that heaven is your home, you can know Jesus today. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God who paid for your sin and was buried and rose again, and he'll give you eternal life. Trust him today. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. Just talk to God. Lord, I know I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And right now I believe Jesus died so that I could live. And I'm trusting in Jesus as the one who paid for my sin. I'm going to turn from my sin and myself and trust in Jesus alone to save me today. That's the prayer of your heart today. If that's the prayer of your heart today, you want to be sure you're saved, will you look to the Lamb and live? And if you are, would you let me know by lifting your hand and putting it back down and say, Pastor, pray for me. I want Jesus today as my Savior. Is there one all across the congregation? Have you trusted Jesus? Oh, I hope you have. Look to the Lamb and live. He thirsted for you so you'll never have to thirst again. He'll satisfy you. Put your faith in him. If you are putting your faith in him, follow him. Might be somebody here this morning and you've never been baptized. You've received Christ, but you've never followed him in believer's baptism. Come today. Make that public confession of your faith. And follow Jesus at a later date in baptism. Maybe you're a member of another church, and this is the place that God would have you move your letter in your life. Become a part of this fellowship. We invite you to come during the invitation and move toward becoming a member of Calvary Baptist Church. Father, thank you so much for this wonderful music that we've heard this morning that calls our attention to behold the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. Oh God, help us to look to the Lamb and live. Help us to follow Christ. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing this hymn of invitation. Dear my God, to be God speaking to your heart today. Make that decision of faith right now. Just a moment, because I want to just remind you of a couple of things. I want Jimmy to go ahead and get up. Jimmy, you go on back to the t-shirt table, would you? If you turn that form in, make sure we get money for the form. If you don't have it today, you can bring it later. But if you want to order your shirt for I Love My Church Day, see Jimmy in the back, and she'll take care of you on the way out. Also, we are in need of nursery workers. I believe there is a form. Am I right? Is there something on the wall for people to sign up for nursery? Okay. Please, volunteer if you can to serve in the nursery. And speaking of the nursery, how many of you saw that Emily had her baby this morning? Isn't that crazy? Yeah. Brother Roy, I love your comment there. Brother Roy's on Facebook. Can you believe that? I love Roy. You don't have to say this is Roy. They see your name when you put the post. But Roy said they look like twins and I'm a twin. I've never seen twins that were born 14 months apart. But anyway, they do look like twins. Little Emmett looks just like little George. I'm telling you, praise the Lord, bless their hearts. Tonight, I'll have a full sermon. I hope you can come back tonight. I talked about family last week, and husbands and wives. And I'm going to give you the rest of the story tonight. It's good for families. It's good for the church. Be here at 6 tonight. Church council meets at 4:30 this afternoon. I wonder how many of you are either eligible for or you're a member of the AARP. Raise your hand. Anybody here? You're eligible to come to Forever Young this Thursday night. This Thursday night. We're having a different style because we're bringing a covered dish or potluck. And we have a special speaker, so let me encourage you to come. Thursday, 6 o'clock. Trying to think, is there anything else?
Yes.
Brother Rock.
You want to move the pulpit and stuff back before we
leave? Yeah, we could use some help, some strong guys, to move the pulpit and communion table back. And then finally, you want a seat next week? Get here early. Because I believe Easter Sunday is going to just be jam-packed. It'll be a great service. And one way to get a seat is get here in time to be in my Sunday school classes. It's right back there in that corner. So you'll be on time because I let you loose early. All right, let's stand together and sing our closing.